up this morning and life as you know it looks nothing like the kind of life you knew before. All of a sudden, fear stole the headlines, and it don't feel safe to even step outside your door. In this world, you will have trouble, but I have overcome the world. So take heart and take a breath. Let me lift that heavy weight up off your chest and take my hand. I know it's looking dark, but when the world falls all around you, I won't let you fall apart. Take heart. Take heart. Do you remember singing back when you were younger? He's got the whole world in his hands. Well, that's still true. I hold your family, all your friends, and all your loved ones. And even when you're barely holding on, I'm holding you. So take heart and take a breath, and let me lift that heavy weight up off your chest and take my hand. I know it's looking dark, but when the world falls all around you, I won't let you fall apart. Take heart. Take heart. But I have overcome the world. Oh, in this world you will have trouble, but I have overcome the world. So take heart and take a breath, and let me lift that heavy weight up off your chest. Take my hand. I know it's looking dark, and when the world falls all around you, I won't let you fall apart. So take heart, child, take heart.
Hello, church, and welcome to online worship with Guilford College United Methodist. We miss seeing you all in the flesh, but we hope each of you is healthy and well. We also hope that you were blessed to see some of those wonderful photos that many of you submitted a few minutes ago in our opening video that was put together for us by Mike Simons of our congregation. For me, seeing those precious images is a reminder that the church is not the building, but that we are the church, that we are the body of Christ, and that Christ is working through us, and that Christ shines through our faces, in our eyes, and in our smiles. We hope, too, that seeing those wonderful pictures would also help us all to embrace the words of that song by Matthew West that was written for these times, that they would help us to take heart, to be encouraged, and to be of good cheer. In the song, Matthew West reminds us of how Jesus promises his disciples, in this world you will have trouble, but be of good cheer, take heart, for I have overcome the world. In another place, Jesus even promises that not even the gates of hell will prevail against his church. And so neither, we know, will this virus. If you're new to our congregation, we want to welcome you as well. Our prayer is that this time would in some way be a blessing to you and that you might experience God's grace through it. We hope that you'll not only watch this time, but that you'll participate and follow along and be in a spirit of worship. In just a moment, Michelle Waldron from our congregation will offer an opening prayer for us and then direct us to a special recitation of that ancient statement of the Christian faith that we call the Apostles' Creed. But first, I want to invite all of us to join in singing together our opening hymn for this fourth Sunday of the season of Easter. It's called Christ Has Risen. Let's sing it together.
My name is Michelle, and I'd like to thank you for tuning in with us at Guilford College United Methodist Church for our service today. Typically, we turn and greet each other with a handshake or a hug, but I'll take care of that today and just say, welcome. We're glad you're here. We're glad you're watching and worshiping with us. I'd also like to say thank you to the people on the AV team that are putting all this content together. It's a way that we can worship together still as a community of faith, and I appreciate that. So thank you very much to all those that are working behind the scenes to get this all together. Last week, the choir, if you didn't catch that, tune in or go check that out. The choir did a song, and it was a very nice to see all those faces of the choir. And Melanie, thank you for getting that all put together, and all the choir members that submitted that. That was great, and I personally enjoyed listening to that, so thank you for that. At this point, will you please just bow with me in prayer? Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for a new month. Oh, Lord, please let May be better than April and get us closer to being able to try and resume some aspect of normal life. Thank you, Lord, for all those doctors, nurses, stalkers at the store, everyone that is trugging along and making our life as normal as it can be and putting themselves out there every day. Lord, please put your protection around them. Lord, please be with those that are sick. Please be with those that are feeling alone at this time. It's very easy to just be in our house and think that we're all by ourselves, but Lord, you're there, you're with us. And thank you for this opportunity to worship together as a community to praise you. Please just be with us in the coming week, guide and direct us, and keep us all safe. Amen. Thank you. And what we're going to watch next is a short video that was created by some United Methodist healthcare workers of North Georgia. And what they're doing is reciting a statement of faith called the Apostles' Creed. So if you know that, please watch and you can join in and say it with them.
I am not afraid. I am fully confident because I believe.
I believe.
I believe.
I believe. I believe.
I believe in God the Father, maker of heaven and earth.
And in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary.
Suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried.
The third day, he arose from the dead.
He ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty.
From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church,
the communion of saints, and the forgiveness of sin, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Friends, we come now to a time in our worship in which we offer our praises and thanksgivings to God, and in which we also share with God our prayers for ourselves and for others. In terms of praises during this time, we praise God for healthcare workers like the ones we just heard reciting the Apostles' Creed, and for all that they're doing right now. We thank God for teachers who face the difficult challenges of helping their students to learn in a new way online. We thank God for essential workers and volunteers who daily are exposing themselves to the risk of illness for the sake of others. We thank God for beautiful, breezy, sunny spring days and for little moments of celebration. I was blessed yesterday to share in one of those moments of celebration as a group from our church staged a raucous horn-honking birthday parade for our friend Cindy Allen. We also thank God for each other's weekly giving of your tithes and your gifts during this time, which is enabling our church to stay strong and to bless so many people, not just in our congregation, but in our community. We hope that you'll take a moment to do that again today, whether it's online or through the mail, or through the secure lockbox that we have now at our church. Amid all these things, we are also thankful to God for glimmers of hope, for signs that we are moving into a new phase in our struggle against COVID-19, and that we are moving ever closer to the day when, even in a limited way, we can gather with one another in person. Even as we share our many thanksgivings with God today, we also share the burdens of our hearts. And in particular, we pray for those in our congregation and in our community who are hurting right now. We pray today for those who are grieving the death of someone dear to them. This week, we pray especially for the family of Carol Teasley, sister to Ann Sykes and Janet Green in our congregation, after her passing on Friday from complications related to the coronavirus. We also remember those whose grief may not be as fresh or as raw, but who during this time have, for whatever reason, even more keenly felt the absence of someone they love who is no longer with them. We pray as well today for the sick. Among those we remember is Helen Blyshack of our church, who is currently a patient at Wesley Long receiving treatments for an intestinal infection. We also pray for several folks in our congregation who are undergoing treatments for cancer. Especially we remember Nick Lubchenko, who underwent a stem cell transplant on Friday, and also Scott Allen and Corey Marion and Jackie Fireball and John Hodges. We ask God to give them strength and well-being in heart and body and mind and spirit. We also pray for those who are suffering from COVID-19, including Beverly Lotz's daughter, Sammy Gann, who lives in Italy. And for those who may be vulnerable to the disease, including Terry and David Hastings, whom we understand may have had a possible exposure to the coronavirus through a caregiver this last week. In addition to all those who struggle with health, we pray for others whose struggle is a little different today. For people who are out of work, who are anxious about their livelihood or their business or their finances, we pray that God would provide for them. And we remember those in prison who may be especially vulnerable to the illness right now, and all people whose circumstances in life may make this time particularly hard for them from day to day. So keeping all those people in our minds and in our hearts, I want to invite you to join with me now in a spirit of prayer for them and for others whom you carry in your own heart today. So let's begin now with a few moments of silence together. And after I've offered some words of prayer on our behalf, we'll close by joining in the Lord's Prayer together. Let us pray. Gracious God, you are our ever-present and never-failing help in trouble. We thank you that you are our port in the storm, that you are our rock and our rescuer. We thank you, God, for the promise you have given through your Son, that though in this broken world we will have trouble, that you have overcome the world, that you can lift the burdens that weigh upon us, that you will take us by the hand and lead us through. God, we pray that you would help us and that you would help all those we have named to take heart today, to have courage, to be of good cheer. As you have overcome the world, help us to be overcomers along with you, to overcome grief, to overcome loneliness, to overcome anxiety, to overcome addiction, to overcome illness, to overcome cancer, and to overcome the shadow of this virus that darkens our world. God, help us to trust that you will see us through, to believe that you are ever working for our good. Help us to know that because you have overcome, we too shall overcome one day. And until that someday comes, O God, give us the faith and the patience and the love and the joy that we need to endure. Give us brave and strong hearts. And as we take heart, help us to receive and share in your heart, so that we might follow the way and take up the cross of your Son Jesus and truly experience all of the overcoming, all-conquering life that he alone can give. All these things, O God, we ask through his Spirit, for his sake, and in his name, and as his people, as his body. We pray together as one the prayer he has taught us in saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Church, now let us conclude our time of praise and prayer by singing together that brief song of praise that we call the doxology. Church, so far in our time of worship, we've gathered together in one spirit to offer our presence to God. And we have offered to God our voices and song, and we've offered to God our praises and our prayers and our gifts. And now our time of worship shifts from a time of offering and giving to a time of receiving, as we listen for what God might say to us through the words of Scripture and through the words of God's children. So we invite you now to open your heart and open your mind to today's children's message from Donna Ford and from her friend Jordan, to our reading from the Bible, which comes from a short and little known but fascinating letter in the New Testament called Philemon, and that will be read for us by Bill Watkins of our congregation. And also to today's sermon message, which will be shared by our associate pastor, Reverend Matt Smith. Listen now for God's word.
Hi, everyone. Jordan and I are glad to be with you again today. I have a seashell with me today because I've been thinking about one of my favorite places in the world, and that is the beach. Have you ever held a conch shell up to your ear and you hear the sound of the ocean waves? It seems like magic, but there's actually a really good explanation. It turns out that when we hear the ocean waves in here, it's really the noises in our bodies that are echoing through the chamber of the shell. And then that triggers in our mind the sound of ocean waves, and that's what we think that we're hearing. But it doesn't matter to me how it happens. I love, love the sound of ocean waves. I do love the ocean, and I think part of that is because it is a place that is so calming and relaxing for me. I love the rhythm of the tide coming in and out. I love looking at all of the creatures and the creation, the seashells and the grains of sand. And I'm reminded that God created all of those and knows the number of all the grains of sand on the ocean. And I am reminded how in control God is. When I look out over the horizon and all I can see is water, I'm just reminded that God's creation and His ability to be in control of me and all things is far greater than I can even imagine. And that really gives me comfort. But long after God created the ocean and the world, He still takes care of all of it, and He takes care of us. Just like a shepherd who takes care of his sheep, God is that shepherd for us. And if you know anything about sheep, you know that they're not very bright, and they need to depend on their shepherd for their most basic needs of just food and water. Same is true for us, depending on God for those things. David wrote Psalm 23 in the Old Testament, and the first three verses of that I just love, and I'm going to share what those are with you today from a kids' version translation of the Bible, and it says that the Lord is my shepherd. He gives me everything that I need. He lets me lie down in green grass. He leads me to quiet waters, and He gives me new strength. So I wonder, is your place of calm the ocean like it is mine? Or is it someplace else, like for King David, it was thinking about God as his shepherd and being his sheep? Where is that place that you find calm with God? Where have you seen God give you calm and peace recently? Where has God given you new strength in these challenging days? And how can we as God's people share that peace and strength with others in the days and weeks to come? Let's pray together. For Almighty God, you are our source of peace and you are our source of strength. We thank you for all of creation and are reminded that you are in control. You set all things into motion and you still take care of all of creation, including us. We thank you for the special place in this world that you have for each of us. And help us today to be renewed by your presence, to find peace with you, and new strength each and every day as we seek you out. For God, you are faithful, you are loving, and you are good. We thank you for your Son, Jesus, and by his Spirit we pray together. Amen.
This letter is from Paul, a prisoner for teaching the good news about Christ Jesus, and from our brother Timothy. I am writing to Philemon, our beloved co-worker, and to our sister, Apphia, and our fellow soldiers, Archippus, and to the church that meets in your house. May God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ give you grace and peace. I always thank my God when I pray for you, Philemon, because I keep hearing that your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all God's people, and I am praying that you will put into action the generosity that comes from your faith as you understand and experience all the good things we have in Christ. Your love has given me much joy and comfort, my brother, for your kindness has often refreshed the hearts of God's people. That is why I am boldly asking a favor of you. I could demand it in the name of Christ, because it is the right thing for you to do. But because of our love, I prefer simply to ask you, consider this as a request from me, Paul, an old man and now a prisoner, for the sake of Christ Jesus. I appeal to you to show kindness to my child, Onesimus. I became his father in the faith while here in prison. Onesimus hasn't been of much use to you in the past, but now he is very useful to both of us. I am sending him back to you, and with him comes my own heart. I want to keep him here with me while I am in these chains for preaching the good news, and he would have helped me on your behalf, but I didn't want to do anything without your consent. I wanted you to help because you were willing, not because you were forced. It seems you lost Onesimus for a little while so that you could have him back forever. He is no longer like a slave to you. He is more than a slave, for he is a beloved brother, especially to me. Now he will mean so much more to you, both as a man and as a brother in the Lord. So if you consider me your partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. If he has wronged you in any way or owes you anything, charge it to me. I, Paul, write this with my own hand. I will repeat it, and I won't mention that you owe me your very soul. Yes, my brother, please do me this favor for the Lord's sake. Give me this encouragement in Christ. I am confident as I write this letter to you that you will do what I ask. And even more, one more thing. Please prepare a guest room for me, for I am hoping that God will answer your prayers and let me return to you soon. Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus, sends you his greetings. So do Mark, Aristarchus, Demas, and Luke, my co-workers. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit.
Hi, friends. Hi church members and attendees and anyone else who may be tuning in. Glad to be with you for another week of worship where we're tuning in remotely. I actually preached from the first week of the quarantine by myself from the corner of the choir's robe room with my cell phone propped up on the hymnal resting on the music stand. Over these last few weeks, we've stepped up our game a little bit, mostly thanks to people who've been extremely generous in sharing their time and technology talents. And the response from you, the congregation, has been phenomenal. We're learning lessons that are not only helpful to know now, but will help to shape ministry even when we're able to get back together in person. The early church was masterful at learning and adapting to changing circumstances, all without losing the heart of the good news. Take the Apostle Paul, for instance. He was great at reaching people when they couldn't be together in person. Paul had at least three stints when he was under arrest. More often, though, Paul just would be tied up in ministry in one area when a messenger came from another church with important news. Since he couldn't drop everything to go to them in person, Paul wrote those churches letters to encourage or correct them. He usually dictated them to a scribe. The letters Paul wrote or that are attributed to him make up over half of the quote-unquote books of the New Testament. There are probably many letters of Paul's that we don't have, but I'm certainly grateful for the ones that we do. When we read the Apostle Paul's letters, it's helpful to remember that he never set out to write a treatise on systematic theology, Christian ethics, a spiritual autobiography. What Paul did was share his conviction that God had raised Jesus Christ from the dead and that salvation was now in reach for everyone through the church. The late author Rachel Held Evans says that the key to interpreting Paul is that everything the apostle writes has an aim to spread the gospel and preserve the unity of the church. All about spreading the gospel, preserving the unity of the church. Possibly the least studied letter of Paul's is the one he sent to a man named Philemon. A man named Onesimus, who was most likely a slave, had left Philemon's house under bad terms. Various theories exist as to how he met up with Paul in prison. Onesimus converts to the faith under Paul's guidance and becomes a dear and important helper to him. While Paul wants Onesimus to continue to be his helper, he believes that Onesimus and Philemon need to be reconciled first. So Paul sends Onesimus back to Philemon with this letter. The letter asks Philemon to forgive the past and treat Onesimus as a brother and a partner. This is the plan that Paul hatches: to spread the gospel and preserve the unity of the church. Part of my choosing this letter today is that it's so rarely preached on. Philemon is a short letter. It's a single chapter with 25 verses. Bill Watkins read the whole thing for us in 3 minutes this morning. At first glance, Philemon appears to lack the grand theological themes of Paul's other letters. It's impossible to fully reconstruct the circumstances behind the letter's writing. And finally, this letter could cause you to see the Apostle Paul maybe in a different and not altogether flattering light. But I like this little letter. I think that Paul is stepping back from the cosmic implications of the gospel to look at what it means to us on personal, intimate terms. Paul's reasoning might lead us to ask, if Christ is truly Lord, what does it change for you and me? How should we now relate to each other? And what debts and hierarchies can we release each other from so that we can be of the most use to God? Won't you pray with me? We thank you, God, for the opportunity this morning to join our hearts, our minds, and our spirits in worshiping you. Use me as I preach this sermon, and use all of us in ever greater ways to spread the gospel, bind the church together, and glorify you in all that we think, say, and do. Amen. One of the great things about being a parent is getting to introduce your children to old movies and TV shows. If you're on the fence about whether or not to have kids, put this solidly in the plus column. One of the things that's helped me and my older son, Simon, get through this time of being at home is by watching the old TV series Lost. And one of the great things about Lost is it has this tremendous villain in the person of Benjamin Linus. Ben has this nearly omniscient ability to get other people to do what he wants. He's a master manipulator. As I read the letter to Philemon this week, I couldn't help but think a little bit about Ben Linus from Lost. Let me be clear, I'm not calling Paul a terrible villain. But because he has such a good and noble purpose in mind in getting Philemon to release Onesimus, Paul is going to use almost every lever of persuasion that's available to him. If you were Philemon, you might feel a little bit manipulated. But whether you consider it manipulation or not, Paul's going to make it nearly impossible for Philemon to say no. The Anchor Bible Dictionary and comments from Ronald Hawk and Mitzi Smith were helpful as I prepared this message. They helped me see quite a few things from Paul's rhetorical bag of tricks that are stuffed into these very few verses. First, Paul's letter is personal but not private. He mentions six people by name on his side who know about this letter. He addresses two other people on Philemon's side. Paul's trying to use peer pressure, only for good this time. Likely at some risk, inconvenience, and expense, Philemon hosts a church in his home. For those acts, Paul calls him a co-worker, friend, and brother. Paul says he prays for Philemon by name, giving thanks to God for him. Paul pays Philemon a number of compliments. Philemon has a reputation for faith in God, love for his fellow believers, and quite possibly hospitality for traveling missionaries. There's a saying that flattery won't get you anywhere, but when it's sincere praise, it does tend to help people be more responsive when you're asking them to do something. In his letter, Paul's also not above invoking a little pity for himself. More than once, Paul points out that he's a prisoner for the sake of the good news and an old man to boot. Paul agrees to personally pay for any damages Onesimus might have caused when he left. And as if underlining that this is a matter important to him personally, Paul points out that this note was handwritten. While Paul only knows Philemon mostly by reputation now, it seems they have some history. This is one other lever of persuasion that he tries to use. Because at one point, Paul says, "I'm too good to bring up the fact that you owe me your own life," which is kind of funny because by bringing it up, Paul did mention it, right? What debt did Philemon owe to Paul? While there's no way to know for certain, the common reading is that Paul was the one who converted Philemon on an earlier mission. It's also worth noting that Paul has converted Onesimus, which is something Philemon was not able to do even when Onesimus was living in his house. Paul says that either by his status or what Philemon owes him personally, it's within his rights to order Philemon to send Onesimus, but Paul prefers that Philemon sends him willingly, out of love for Paul. As we'll see more in a minute, names often mean something, and Philemon's name contains the Greek word for brotherly love. When the letter ends, it's an open question as to whether Philemon will treat Onesimus like an angry slave owner or as a beloved brother. As Paul tries to get Philemon to see, the more genuinely you love people, the less compelled you feel to pull rank on them. Near the end of the letter, Paul says that he hopes to come and visit Philemon soon himself. You could read that as an encouragement or as a warning. If he still finds Onesimus treated like a lowly slave, Paul might not be happy. So those are lots of ways, right, that Paul tries to persuade Philemon. It's like Don Corleone. Paul might as well have told Philemon, "I'm going to make you an offer you can't refuse." I can't remember if I've actually ever seen The Godfather or I've just seen parodies of it, but that's my Marlon Brando. But one argument that Paul does not make, but which we might wish he did make, is a condemnation of the whole institution of slavery. It's not even entirely clear that Paul's asking Philemon to set Onesimus free legally. In fact, during slaveholding times here in the States, the letter of Philemon was sometimes used to argue against the abolition of slavery. They pointed out that Paul sent a may have sent a runaway slave home to his master. And if God thinks slavery is morally wrong, why didn't Paul say so, either here or in his other letters? And how should we in this day and age read this or the other 268 biblical verses that either condone or prescribe slavery? What do we make of that? One thing we can say is that slavery in the Greco-Roman world was not as degrading and brutal as slavery in the American South. In many places, Roman slaves had rights, could own property, would be set free by the age of 30. Some people argue that the Greek word in the New Testament that we render as slave is better translated servant. It's important for us to say that while Christians are called to loyal service to God, we're not being called to the sorts of abuse that American slaves endured. Also, while Paul may have longed for one slave that he knew personally, he may have implored Philemon to release this one slave from his duties, he might not have been able to imagine a world totally devoid of slavery. And this is true for the other biblical authors who were inspired by God to write what they did, but were also products of their time. Moreover, Paul and most of the early Christians in the early first century were convinced that Christ's return was imminent. And because he believed that Jesus would return to judge and rule the earth in his lifetime, Paul was less concerned with social reform than evangelism. Another thing we can say is that even if Paul thought slavery was morally wrong at all times and places, Christians were marginal, often persecuted. They regularly faced charges that following Jesus made them bad citizens. For that reason, Paul might not have been willing to attack the institution of slavery directly. He might have calculated that it would do more harm than good if such a stand hindered the spread of the gospel and hurt the unity of the church. But even if it's done indirectly, Paul does challenge those unjust power structures. He does challenge what would lead human beings to enslave one another. In his letter to Philemon, as in other places, the apostle insists that whether our legal status is slave or free, we share the same master in heaven. Sometimes Paul gets portrayed as some kind of regressive boogeyman, but it's clear from this letter and in other places that Paul was radical for his times. As I said earlier, some slaveholders quoted Paul to justify continued slavery, but abolitionists also took their inspiration from Paul. After all, it was Paul who said in Galatians 3:28 that for those who are in Christ Jesus, the old social distinctions of Jew, Greek, man, woman, slave, or free didn't count for anything. Christian social reformers in every day and age have been encouraged by Paul's idea that what we share in common when we place our faith in Christ is more significant than anything that would divide or demote us. The love that God has for us, the love we're supposed to have for each other, makes us equals before God. So while it may or may not be implied that Paul wants Philemon to release Onesimus legally, Paul does want Onesimus to be released from his debts and from his obligations in order to be of the greatest use. This is the argument he makes that I'm most interested in today. You see, we're most useful when our service is freely given in love for the sake of Jesus and his good news. In his letter to Philemon, Paul makes a pun. See, the name Onesimus means useful in the Greek. It was possibly a name that Philemon had given to the young man when he became his slave. The gist of Paul's request to Philemon is this: you only thought Onesimus was useful before. In reality, though, what you had him doing for you was useless. What I'm asking you to do is to release him to be truly useful to me, to you, and most importantly, to God. Philemon, will you regard Onesimus as your brother and release him to be useful in all the ways that he can be? That's a good question. That's the main point of this letter. Will you release Onesimus? You regard him as your brother and let him be useful in all the ways that he can be. And as we said, as Paul has now worked pretty much every lever or persuasion available to him, I can only imagine that Philemon's answer was yes. Imagine that if Paul did get to go visit his house, Philemon would have sent Onesimus with him, with the permission to go and be wherever you can be of the greatest use. It's not an accident that I thought of this passage, this New Testament letter this week, that I've chosen to preach on it. It's because, like Paul pleading on behalf of Onesimus, I'm also asking for your blessing to leave Guilford College United Methodist Church. Our Bishop Paul Leland, District Superintendent Bev Copley of the Northern Piedmont District, believe that I'll be of greatest use as pastor in charge of Faith United Methodist Church, effective July 1st. Faith UMC is in Indian Trail. It's a town situated a little east of Charlotte. Joanna, the boys, and I will be settling into the church's parsonage in nearby Monroe this summer. For those of you who are not familiar with the United Methodist appointive system, elders like Jeremy and I usually serve for a year at a time and then are reappointed to the same congregation or appointed to a new one. When I was ordained, I vowed to go wherever the bishop sent me, wherever the bishop thought I would be of greatest use. The bishop and his cabinet take into consideration the desires of the churches and pastors, but they have the ultimate say, the ultimate authority as to who goes where. Our Methodist model is not a perfect system for providing pastors to churches, but it does have many advantages. And as it's been pointed out frequently, it's also the model that's closest to that of the New Testament, where church leaders strategically and prayerfully sent apostles to the places where they imagined those apostles would be of the greatest use. When I was growing up in the United Methodist Church, we changed pastors more frequently. It seemed like every 3 or 4 years, whether things were going well or poorly, it just seemed more arbitrary. Nowadays, pastors are moved less often and with more intention. Appointments now average around 7 years, which has been the length of my time serving here. You know, it's hard to contemplate leaving Guilford College after these years that have meant so much to me. One of the times that it struck me really hard was last Sunday as we heard that tremendous choir anthem that Melanie put together. And as the choir sang in their little socially distanced boxes on my laptop screen, I just thought of the ways that each one of that crowd had blessed me and encouraged me and laughed with me and loved on me and my family and shared their hearts and some really powerful life experiences with me. And it was almost too much. And that's what was happening when I was looking at 25 people, not the whole stinking church. If you'd only been worse to me here, church, it would make leaving a whole lot easier. It really was a hard decision for me to request a transfer. I pushed our district superintendent, Bev, for two extensions. I'm not known for my decisiveness generally, but this was an especially hard choice. My family loves it here. My ministry's been well accepted. It's a great church staff. It's so much fun to work with them. I enjoyed a really strong relationship with Tom Gibson, who was lead pastor before, and our new lead pastor, Jeremy, has been phenomenal. There's some things that I can see on the horizon for this church that it would be amazing to be a part of. But after 20 years on church staffs and as an associate pastor, there was also this feeling that I needed to push myself. If I was going to develop some gifts for preaching and leadership to the greatest potential, I was going to need to use them in new ways as the pastor in charge of a congregation. That's why I asked for this change. This appointment has been great for me. I'm so thankful for the wide variety of ways I've had the opportunity to be of use here. A few things I've done in ministry have not gone as well as I'd hoped. More things we've done together have gone really well. And both those experiences, both types of experience, have helped me grow. Along the way, you've been extraordinarily patient, encouraging, and kind. And Faith UMC and all the other churches that I might serve in my ministry are going to benefit from what I learned here. Leaving the church is always hard. It's, as you can imagine, doing so during the midst of a pandemic is not much easier. All the wheels for this move were set in motion for the appointment change long before I'd ever heard of COVID-19. And for now, Joanna's continuing to work 3 days a week while I watch the boys and help them with their schoolwork. I work a couple of full days, and the rest of the week I'm working in fits and spurts and odd times. And I don't want to come across as complaining, because I'm so fortunate to have a flexible job and a healthy family and a loving church. I'm just afraid that our dwindling time and these current circumstances aren't going to adequately allow me time to thank each one of you, to tell each one of you how much you mean to me. But frankly, I couldn't thank you enough if I was here every day, all day, 7 days a week between now and the end of June. Couldn't thank you enough. When we came to the church, Simon was 6 and David was 3. Yesterday, Simon turned 13. He's the one of us having the hardest time with this move right now. Simon doesn't remember much before we moved to Greensboro, and he'll leave behind a lot of wonderful friends at church and at school. I think David's going to be okay. He's going to miss hugging everybody's neck on his way out to children's worship, who was on the center aisle. He'll miss the kids who treated him so well and accepted him so lovingly. He's going to miss those adults who worked so hard to allow him to participate in the life of the church. Joanna and I will always remember how well you loved our boys. You loved me and Joanna well, too. Your support was never more strongly felt than when Joanna's dad died in January. Such grief is never easy, but it was made easier by the loving care that you gave us. And when we move to Monroe, Joanna's going to take a well-deserved break from work for a while we get adjusted to a new place and figure out what further curves COVID-19 may throw our way. But friends, one of the things that makes me feel better about leaving is because I'm a great admirer of the new associate pastor who's coming to succeed me here. Her name is Susan Suarez Webster, and I came to know Susan in the last 2 years as she's been the associate at Central UMC in Charlotte. Annette's going to say more about her in a minute. And let me just say that Susan is too humble to brag about it, but according to her former senior pastor, she was the driving force, the linchpin in helping that congregation branch out to reach every sort of person in its community. And that's something we've longed for and hoped for and prayed for here at GCMC for a long time. So I can only imagine that Susan's going to be of great use. Again, SBRC and Annette and all the folks there are going to be sharing more about her in the weeks to come. But what I would say is, to paraphrase what Paul said to Philemon, that I would hope that you would treat Susan just as well as you would me. And I'm confident that you'll love her and that she'll love you. When I talked to Jeremy about preaching on Philemon this Sunday, and when I was sharing the news with you, he wanted to check and make sure that I wasn't saying that the last 7 years have been like a time of indentured servitude or slavery. It's not been that at all. That's not the connection I was trying to make. What I'm trying to say is that I feel like my most useful days here are behind me, and I hope and pray that with your blessing, there'll be even more useful days ahead of me in another place. But for now, I still got 2 more months of ministry here. I'm confident that we'll find plenty of ways to be of use between now and the end of June. Won't all be teary farewells. I'll be working hard to hand things off and wrap things up and otherwise ensure the smoothest possible transition here at this church. But pray for me and family, and pray for Susan and hers, and pray for this church. And while you're at it, pray for all the churches and pastors that'll be experiencing changes this summer. Most of all, pray that God will use all of us to hasten that day when His will is done no less here than it is in heaven. And until that day, receive the blessing with which the Apostle Paul concludes his letter to Philemon. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Alleluia. Amen.
Trust in you alone, higher than my sight, high above my Greetings, members and friends of Guilford College United Methodist Church. My name is Annette Lassley, and I am the chair of the Staff Parish Relations Committee at our church. By now you have heard of Reverend Matt Smith's announcement and his upcoming transition. As your Staff Parish Chair, it is my duty to confirm to you that Bishop Leland and his cabinet have appointed Matt Smith to be the lead pastor at a church east of Charlotte, effective July 1st. I share this news with mixed emotions. We are very excited for this new opportunity for Matt, but the hallways of Guilford College United Methodist Church will miss his energy, his compassion, and his warm smile. Matt has been a tremendous asset to the church, most recently expanding our outreach to the community and shepherding and leading the youth while the search for a new youth leader continues. We find ourselves living through extraordinary events, unlike anything seen in our lifetime. However, the work of the church must continue, and the Staff Parish Relations Committee asks that you specifically pray for Matt, his family, and for his new church, Faith United Methodist in Indian Trail, North Carolina. Also pray for our church, Guilford College United Methodist Church, that we may continue to discern and follow God's will for our congregation. I'm sure you're wondering what's next for us. It's my pleasure to announce that our new associate minister will be Reverend Susan Swartz Webster, previously assigned to Central United Methodist Church in Charlotte. Her husband, Tim, is also a minister and will be starting a new appointment in the surrounding area as well. Susan and Tim have two adult sons. Susan's many talents include teaching, community missions, and local outreach. Susan is fluent in both English and in Spanish, an ability that will be an asset to the many organizations and communities we serve. We're very excited about this new chapter, set to begin later this summer. The Staff Parish Relations Committee is exploring ways that we can adhere to social distancing guidelines and safely say farewell to Matt and hello to Susan. As these plans take place, we'll be back in touch with everyone on how we can participate. Thank you, and God bless.
Well, hello again, church. By now, you will have heard Matt's announcement about his upcoming transition, about how he and Joanna and Simon and David will be moving to Indian Trail this summer in July. And you've heard some of our youth sing a song about what it means to say to Jesus, "I will follow you." And that's exactly what Matt and his family are doing. And you've had a chance, too, to hear Annette Lassley confirm that change. and also to be able to tell us just a little bit about the person who will be becoming our new associate pastor, Susan Suarez Webster. We know that this kind of announcement brings up all kinds of emotions in us. Some of you of us may have been anticipating the possibility of a change like this. Others of us might be surprised and had no idea that this was on the horizon, and it's added to a season when there have been so many changes that we've had to adapt to and adjust to. We have all kinds of emotions. Matt and Joanna and Simon and David are so beloved in our congregation and our community and have been such an important part of us. We are so grateful to Matt for all that he has shared here and for the ways that God has truly used him in offering pastoral care, in leading our church in amazing partnerships and service opportunities in the community, with his servant spirit, with his good humor, with his willingness to truly be of use in any way that God might be calling in this place. For all those reasons, it is hard to see him go, even though at the same time we are excited to see the ways that God is going to use him and his family in the future, in just the way he spoke about in his message. If there's anyone from Faith United Methodist Church in Indian Trail watching this, you're getting a good one. And we'll be praying for you and for Matt as you start what is going to be a beautiful season of ministry together. We know that it's not only hard just making this announcement, but that it's difficult the way that we've had to share this news. As we live under restrictions of gathering and as we've had to share it with you through a recorded message, we wish that we had been able to all be together in the sanctuary as Matt shared that word, and we could have all gathered around and prayed, and you could have had a chance after the service to go up and to give him a hug and shake his hand. Unfortunately, we're not able to do that today. We are hopeful that we're going to be able to have some wonderful ways to honor Matt and his family, and to say goodbye to them and to bless them as they prepare to leave. We're grateful that we still have 2 months with them until the end of June. We expect June 28th or so to be Matt's last Sunday with us. And our staff parish committee is talking about different ways that we can do that. We probably are going to wait closer to that late June time in the hope that maybe there might be some kind of in-person gatherings allowed to us. But we're going to make plans for either kind of scenario because it's important for us to do that in the right way. One of the things that we're doing as soon as today that we hope might be helpful to you is that at 2:30 p.m. today on Sunday, we are setting up a Zoom webinar that Matt is going to be on. We're offering this as a chance for people to sign on and just bring Matt your greetings and to ask him any questions, just to get to hear from him a little more in person than in a recorded message and to interact with him. And so if your heart is touched by this announcement today and you know you're going to have a chance later to say more, but you just wanted to kind of connect with Matt in some way today, we want to invite you to join us at 2:30 p.m. today, Sunday afternoon, through this Zoom call as a chance to do that. You will be receiving, if you're part of our church's email list, an email around 1 p.m. today that will include both this announcement and that will have the link you will click on to join that kind of virtual receiving line. We do ask, we're limited to around 100 households being able to join that call. So if you're a part of a household and all of you want to join, if you could just use one computer, it would help us in that process. We hope that this just might help us to process this news today and also to begin expressing to God and to Matt our gratitude for all of the ways that God has used him here, and for us to express our appreciation for his family as well. We also look forward in the coming next few weeks to telling you more about Reverend Susan Suarez Webster and introducing some things about her to you. But today we're focusing a little bit more on acknowledging this news of Matt's transition. Friends, as we go through this time where there are so many changes happening around us, we're reminded again that
God is our rock, and that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And we are confident that he is going to continue to use Pastor Matt, that he's going to continue to use us, that he's going to use Pastor Susan in beautiful ways. We look forward to sharing in that together, even as we feel so many emotions today to recognize that we're going to be saying goodbye to a beloved friend and pastor. So maybe it's best now, as we come to the close of our time of worship, to share both with Pastor Matt and his family and with one another the familiar words of benediction that I wrote about this past week in my pastor's epistle. They come to us from the words of Scripture in the sixth chapter of the book of Numbers, and they are an ancient blessing that so many of us have taken up into the church and used in youth groups and college ministries and in small groups. As we close our service today, that beautiful blessing conveys all that we want to say to Pastor Matt and his family and to one another. And so if you would receive those words now, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.